Well, welcome everybody. Welcome to our Memorial Presents session that we've called Healthcare in 2020. Can Newfoundland and Labrador lead the way? My name is Mike Clare. I'm the Associate Director at Memorial University's Leslie Harris Center of Regional Policy and Development. It's my pleasure to welcome you here this evening. I'd like to welcome those of you who are watching via the internet, but a special welcome to those of you who are here with me in the Angus Bruno Lecture Theatre for having braved a slushy and wet February evening. So welcome to all. We've selected our title, Healthcare in 2020, because of its double meaning. On the one hand, we're looking 9 years into the future, at about the time that students entering medical school this year will be graduating as specialists. And on the other, we're using the 2020 analogy of optometry, because we're trying to envision the future in the clearest possible way. In a moment, I'm going to invite a representative of our partner organization this evening, the Newfoundland Labrador Center for Applied Health Research, to provide a bit more context for the session. But first, let me outline the structure of the session here this evening. We're going to have two presenters who will each speak for about a half hour. And then in the other hour, or whatever time is remaining before 9:30, we're going to engage in a Q&A discussion with you here in the audience. So for those of you who are here with me in the room, we're going to circulate a couple of wireless microphones. So please identify yourselves. We'll get the microphone over to you. We want to make sure that those watching on the internet can hear your question. And for those who are watching on the internet, on the screen below, you will find my email address. So if you want to ask a question or make a comment, please email me the question and we will read out your question or comment here, interspersed with the other questions from the audience members here. So, and the discussion session will be moderated by my colleague, Dr. Rob Greenwood, who's the director of the Harris Center. We're going to adjourn at 9:30, and those of you who are here with me in the room, I invite you to come with us to the lobby and continue the discussion during a reception afterwards. This session is being webcast. We are going to archive it afterwards. So in a day or so, this session should be archived on the website of the Harris Center and for the Center of Applied Health Research. So if you want to see the session again, or if you want to refer it to friends or colleagues, you'll be able to do that in a couple of days. One last housekeeping item, if you would, if you have a cell phone or anything that beeps or buzzes, if you'd set it to vibrate, that would be great. It's now my pleasure to invite to the podium Janice Butler, Senior Research Officer and Program Coordinator with the Newfoundland Labrador Center for Applied Health Research, to provide a bit more context for this evening's discussion and to introduce our two guest speakers.
Good evening. Thanks, Mike. As Mike has noted in his introduction, I am the coordinator of the Contextualized Health Research Synthesis Program at the Newfoundland Labrador Center for Applied Health Research, and I'm delighted this evening to have the opportunity to bring greetings to you on behalf of the center. It is a pleasure for us to partner with the Harris Center on this opportunity for public discussion on the future of healthcare, a topic that affects all of us and a topic that often affects each person from a variety of angles. We are employees of the health system, we are patients, we are healthcare providers, we are unpaid caregivers, we are health policymakers, we are educators, we are researchers, we are taxpayers, and we are engaged citizens. The Center for Applied Health Research, which is now in its 12th year of operations, has a mandate to contribute to the effectiveness of the province's health system and to the health and well-being of the province's population by supporting the development and the use of applied health research. Much of the research supported by our center helps to answer the key questions about the sustainability of our healthcare system and how best to help our province's people to live longer, healthier lives. Fundamental questions that will be addressed by tonight's presentations. And all of us as engaged citizens will bring our own experience and expertise to this discussion. These conversations are important for looking not only at the challenges faced by our health system, but also to examine some concrete solutions. Tonight's excellent presenters are two health system experts who are closely affiliated with the Center for Applied Health Research through our board of directors. Dr. Jim Rourke is our chair, and John Abbott is a former member of our board. We know that they will provide much food for thought and I look forward to participating in a lively discussion after their presentations. Please allow me, first of all, to introduce Mr. John Abbott. John Abbott is currently Chief Executive Officer with the Health Council of Canada. Prior to joining the Health Council, John was a management consultant specializing in public policy analysis and development. Previous to this, John was Deputy Minister of the Newfoundland Labrador's Department of Health and Community Services, where he oversaw the reorganization of the province's system of regional health authorities and the expansion of the provincial drug program to meet the needs of low-income families and those with high drug costs. For 10 years, between 1989 and 1999, he held a number of senior positions. He was Assistant Secretary to the Treasury Board, Associate Deputy Minister of Health and Community Services, Chairman and CEO of the Newfoundland Labrador Housing Corporation, Deputy Minister of Work, Services and Transportation, and Deputy Minister of Municipal and Provincial Affairs. John served with distinction as a senior government executive in the Newfoundland for Newfoundland Labrador, for which he was recognized with the Lieutenant Governor's Award for Excellence in Public Administration by the Institute of Public Administration of Canada. John has a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science and Economics from Memorial University of Newfoundland and an MA in Public Administration from Carleton University in Ottawa. John is also active in community affairs, has an interest in heritage property redevelopment, and enjoys hiking. Moving on to Dr. Rourke. Dr. Jim Rourke has served as the Dean of Medicine and Professor of Family Medicine at Memorial University of Newfoundland since his appointment in April 2004. He is currently Chair of the Board for all of Canada's Faculties of Medicine. He previously served as the Assistant Dean of Rural Regional Medicine at the University of Western Ontario, where he was a professor in the Department of Family Medicine. Since moving to Newfoundland and Labrador, Dr. Rourke has traveled extensively throughout the province and in New Brunswick to visit teaching sites. Dr. Rourke was an active rural family physician, including obstetrics and emergency work in Goderich, Ontario for 25 years with his wife and partner, Dr. Leslie Rourke. He has a long-standing interest in rural medicine and medical education and is a recognized leader at provincial, national, and international levels. He was very involved in the initial development work that led to the approval to build the Northern Ontario Medical School. He was chair of the World Organization of Family Doctors Working Party in Rural Practice, which has organized 7 World Rural Health Conferences, and was involved in developing a joint WONCA and World Health Organization project entitled Health for All Rural People. Dr. Rourke has received many honors, including an honorary degree from the University of Western Ontario, and awards including from the College of Family Physicians of Canada, the College of Physicians and Surgeons of Ontario, the University of Western Ontario, and the Ontario College of Family Physicians. He has had more than 90 medical journal articles published, mostly in peer-reviewed journals. So thank you very much, and I'll give you Mr. John Abbott.
Well, it should be time to go home after those introductions. Well, thank you very much, and thanks, Michael and the Harris Center, for sponsoring this event this evening. And belated happy Valentine's to those who didn't get to enjoy it yesterday, and also to remember the anniversary of the sinking of the Ocean Ranger. So we have a lot of history and memories to think about while we talk about healthcare in this province and in this country. My topic tonight is really a simple one. I'm sort of setting the stage for Jim Rourke. Jim being the academic as well as the physician will definitely have more answers than I. But I can ask questions and I will want answers both as an administrator, as a policymaker, and as a member of the public who relies on the healthcare system for my needs, my family's needs, and my community's needs. So we've sort of worked with Mike at the Harris Center in setting this up and wanted to come up with a theme that is looking forward, and I think Mike did an admirable job talking about that. When I was asked to sort of frame my presentation, I thought back basically a year ago and the Winter Olympics, and owning the podium was certainly something that Canada aspired to at that time. So I've titled my presentation, Owning the Healthcare Podium 2020. So before we get to 2020, the question is, and this cartoon asks the question, will our system run out of gas? The big topic on most minds in government, certainly in the finance ministries and health ministries, and the people that advise them, is the whole issue of the sustainability. And the issue of Medicare and universality and all those questions consequently get put on the table. I would suggest to you that, no, the system will not run out of gas, but we owe it to ourselves to make sure we get it right in the meantime. So I've titled or put this presentation together in terms of four themes. Did you know, which is really asking or showing some financial and healthcare statistics that might be of interest to set the stage from a Canadian context and international context. What is our response to the current healthcare issues that that are before us? And really looking at it from the perspective of governments and the media, who are purveyors of many of our thoughts. Is there a better way which sets the stage for a vision for 2020? And can we own the healthcare podium by that time? So did you know Canada has 14 healthcare systems, not one? So what you get in Newfoundland may be different from what you get in Nova Scotia, what you'll get in British Columbia. So it is co-owned, co-managed by our 14 governments. That's the 10 provinces, the three territories, and the federal government. So when we are looking at our healthcare system, first and foremost, obviously, we're interested in what's happening in this province. But we are also part of the quote-unquote national system. And what happens in, for instance, Ontario does impact and affect us quite significantly here in this province when it comes to recruitment, retention, and training of professionals. Physicians is a good case in point. When the Ontario government makes a significant policy decision, such as it did with generic drug pricing, it does reverberate across the province and territories, and we need to be mindful of what happens there. Main point being is that we really need to be all working together to serve the Canadian public. So this slide is basically showing the increase in healthcare spending over a 10, 11, and 12-year period. And basically what it shows is that from the period 1998 to 2007, healthcare spending in this country doubled. And we asked the question, if you thought 10 years ago that it would double, would you think that would actually happen? Then we look at 2009, it's increased, 2010, it's increased. We are on the same trajectory to see healthcare spending in this country double yet again in a 10-year period. The question is, what are we getting for it? So in terms of some of the specific expenditure areas that we are familiar with, hospitals, drugs, and doctors, this graph shows you the increase, shares an increase in expenditures. And the interesting point, I guess, there among several, is the fact that our expenditure on drugs is surpassing our expenditure on physicians. It is the growing area in healthcare spending that is showing the most impact on healthcare and health outcomes. At the same time, we see certainly the rise in expenditure on hospitals, and when we look at that, that is primarily dealing with the services that diagnostic services, treatment services, and but primarily it is dealing with salaries within the hospital setting and hospital costs. Personnel costs make up about 70% of hospital costs. So that is reflective of inflation, salary increases, and more delivery of services. And it's an area that is of concern to most health ministries in terms of rising costs. So where does Canada stand in relation then to other countries in terms of their expenditures or our expenditures on healthcare? This is a graph taken out of an OECD study released recently. And in Canada, we're spending 10.1% of our GDP on healthcare. The OECD average is roughly just under 9%. And for the United States, 16%, which is obviously the significant outlier. For those who are here in the room that can see this, when you look at the United States and Canada in terms of public expenditures, we are basically spending about the same amount in terms of GDP. And that's not widely recognized or known vis-a-vis the United States. So in Canada, of our total expenditures on health, roughly 70% is paid through the public purse. Now, this is 2009. Actually, in the past year, that percentage for Canada probably increased due to the recession. But on I'll say, an average period of time, we are usually in the 10% range. So, moving ahead in terms in, okay, so we're spending all this money, we're buying all these health services. What are Canadians thinking about that, and what are other people in other countries thinking about their system, and how do they rate their particular healthcare systems? This particular slide talks about Canadian responses compared with other countries. So we are saying 38% of us think the system works pretty well and only minor changes are necessary to make it better, versus the UK, which says 63%. Netherlands 52%, Switzerland 47%. We conducted a webinar yesterday with these three representatives from the three top performing countries and looked at and asked them why they think they rated much higher than Canada. And when you look at access to care, timeliness of care, coordination of care through primary health care services and affordability, Canada rates much, much lower than those three countries. And these are areas that are within our domain to address. We don't think the situation in Newfoundland and Labrador would be anywhere different than sort of the Canadian norm on that. So, did you know that we have an explosion of chronic health conditions and that poorer Canadians are really facing significant challenges? They have the poorest health, and the gap between the poor and with poor health and Canadians who are earning medium to high incomes is growing in this country. And it is one of the alarming things that policymakers are focusing on. We have an aging society, but it is not the specific driver of healthcare cost. We see now, based on the previous graph, when we looked at the causes of increased spending in Canada for that 10-year period, roughly 11% of that increase is attributed to our aging population, approximately 14% due to population growth, and 27% due to inflation. So we need to look at the aging factor in perspective. That being said, more of us, as we grow older, will have chronic health care conditions, which will, if we do things as usual, will definitely drive up health care costs. And consumer expectations. We all want the latest drug, the latest technology, the latest service. We are users of and readers of the internet, and we get our health information that we can use in our conversations with our physicians. And we are consumers, and we look at healthcare not only as delivering health, but we look at it as delivering a service, and we expect, as we do with other services, that we are treated with respect and that our needs are addressed, and we're more interested in having our needs addressed than focusing on the system issues. So again, did you know, and this is just showing the prevalence of diabetes in Canada over the past 10 years, and it is basically doubled. And for many of you, that's not news, but is alarming fact of our society. Within that, we look at obesity and an interprovincial comparison, and obesity being an indicator of diabetes. And we are seeing, obviously in this case, Newfoundland is at the high end of the spectrum, though we have dropped down marginally. And as I said to one person, and we've noticed that Alberta's gone up, population shift, maybe explain. Maybe explain as simple as that. So but yeah, again, something to worth for the researchers in the room to think about. And when we look at, and that's obesity in right across our population, but what is alarming, and again, certainly reported through the media, but governments are reacting but not giving as much attention as one would like, is around child obesity, though the health ministers have signed a pact to address that now in Canada. But that's September 2010. We've known this for quite some number of years. The next slide talks about seniors who reported having one or more of 11 chronic conditions. And there, Canada, I'm sure Newfoundland is rated the highest at 85% of our seniors' population having chronic diseases. Again, not a surprise. But it is high for Canada as a whole in any event. So it is, one could argue, the canary in the coal mine, not the gold mine. So what is the Canadian response? These are just some numbers. But when we look at what governments are saying, and if you go to their speeches, their reports, their documentation over the past couple of years, their focus tends to be financial and economic, not on health and health outcomes. And it has been reflected in a lot of the media coverage and a lot of the pundits who are talking about, can we afford it? How much can we afford? Those kinds of questions. And not on, well, what are we doing with the money we currently have? How can we extract greater value? So when we look, and then the question sort of flips around, and when you look at then the expenditures relative to our own individual provincial economies, we see some startling numbers. Now, this is taken out of the budgets of last year. It'll be interesting to see, obviously, where we stand in the coming budget season. But if you look at Newfoundland, consumer price index of 3.2%, GDP growth of 3.1%, those numbers might have changed slightly, we're spending at 10%. And we have been spending at that level for quite a number of years in Newfoundland. And as a deputy minister, we rated our success, one of the factors of our success is how much money you get out of the Treasury Board for healthcare. Well, we were quite successful. The question is, what did we in fact do with the money? Ontario, which is in dire financial straits, deficits now at $20 billion a year, and no particular plan to get out of it, their healthcare spending is growing by 4% this year. At least that's the plan. But that means wage freezes, cutting expenditures, and what have you. Alberta, again, was showing healthcare spending of around 15%. Now, there is some one-time money in that because they bailed out the Alberta Health Services Board, which was set up to solve all their problems. It would be interesting to see what, in fact, materializes. And in BC, again, with relatively speaking, a higher percentage of seniors living in that province, was looking at spending at 4.6%. Canada, this is the 6% is really the transfer payments for health to the provinces. So if you're just looking at that particular page, the finances and economics of the provinces doesn't support the level of spending as it currently exists. So something has to give here. Either they reconstruct their finances, and some are suggesting that needs to be done, or they have to reconfigure some of their healthcare spending. At the same time, while they're doing that, and we're doing that, we need to figure out what it is we want to achieve here. So what is the Canadian response? And this is really what is the Canadian's response through the media. So Jeffrey Simpson, who, you know, is well known, I think, to many of us, he, again, is focused on the question of sustainability. And he's been writing consistently now for the past 2 or 3 years. Interestingly, you never hear of a minister replying to him through the media. Andre Picard, I think the top health care sort of journalist reporter in this country, very knowledgeable, not a confrontationalist or and not to excite the public, very factual in his reporting. And he makes the case that we have to tackle poverty, poor housing, and inequality, bolster education, and create healthier environments if we are, in fact, going to address the healthcare issue. I'll speak to that in a moment. Don Drummond, former TD VP, chief economist, just completed a report on the Ontario healthcare system at the request of the Ontario Ministry, had a 10-point plan to help solve their challenges. And he is making the case that we need to involve, you know, yes, governments are going to be involved, but we need to make sure the doctors, nurses, hospitals, drug companies, policy analysts, and others are there to collaborate, develop options. One group he certainly has not put in there, I don't by omission, is obviously the public, the citizen, the patient in developing those choices. Interesting, his last line here, it says, only when the communications and conditioning have been done will government step up to the plate. So it sounds rather Machiavellian, one could argue. Tom Blackwell from the National Post, you know, would be say on the conservative side of the media. But he, again, quoting from one of the country's biggest hospitals, he's saying Canadian hospitals will continue to be plagued by overcrowding and other problems unless the current system of funding is basically changed, and that we target the payments to reward safe, effective, and efficient care. And that's gaining a lot more momentum across the country, and you're getting more hospital administrators speaking to that point as well. So it would appear, and I accept, that they're up for that challenge. So this probably should be titled, What Should Be the Canadian Response? And Jim will help answer some of these questions. What is the right amount of money to spend on healthcare? Is there a better or smarter way to spend the healthcare dollars that we have? Will tackling the social determinants of health, like poverty, result in better health? Or will we continue to ignore their significance? Now, I can say, from my perspective, that Newfoundland Labrador has been sort of a leader through its poverty reduction strategy, because it's actually named the problem called poverty. It has put in plans and money to address the issues and has tied in health, education, housing, and other sectors to address this joint challenge. Again, the numbers and all the research will tell us that if we have good incomes, good jobs, and good housing, we're not running to the health to our healthcare provider to the same degree that if we're in the opposite position. Sweden has just put out a report through their Quality Council, and very, very compelling data. And they're able to track education levels, quality of job, incomes, with health and health conditions and use of health system. And whatever way you want to draw the graph, it is a straight line, a very, very, very high correlation. Again, we know this to be true in Canada, but we're not acting on the information in terms of driving our healthcare policies. And do we have a vision for Canada? The federal government currently has been relatively quiet when it comes to healthcare. We'll give the provinces their health transfer, end of story. We may talk about it in 2014 when the current health accords expire. We may not. Time will tell. So we're challenged at the federal level to provide a vision at this point. The opposition parties obviously are working on their visions. What do we have in Newfoundland for a vision for healthcare? When we read through the documentations, when we hear the health minister, the premier of the day speak, we certainly see a commitment to improving our healthcare system, to improve access and to address the issues around our rural communities. But is our vision any more than that? That's what we need to consider. So from the Health Council of Canada's perspective, what we think this period of time is an opportunity to consider how we improve access, how we improve quality, how we improve the sustainability of the Canadian healthcare system, i.e. each of the provincial and territorial healthcare systems, because without addressing all, we're really not going to achieve what we need from a Canadian perspective. So we really need to look at, we've got an input, output, outcome sort of model here, and we need to look at how we use resources and are we using them to their maximum and most efficient effect. Do we have the right services in place? Primary health care is critical. We do not, in this province, have the right model in place. But we can and should be moving towards that. Other provinces are also, in many respects, at the same point we are. And in terms of health outcomes, do we just want more health care or do we want better health outcomes for our children and for our grandparents? So we need to focus on those objectives, those goals, and then redesign where we need to, the systems that can support that. So if there is only one thing that we need to do immediately would be to re-engage with and through our primary healthcare system and focus on chronic disease management in this province and in this country. Though Canadians with chronic disease are the higher users of the service, and they're also, in many respects, the most dissatisfied with the service. So how do we turn that around? And we turn that around by making sure that the patients are more engaged and when the supports are in place so they can participate in their care. We're currently working on a report on this topic of patient engagement. The research is underway in this country, how we can improve patient engagement processes, systems, and for results. And the results show, yet again, in Canada, relative to other countries, we do less than average when it comes to effective patient engagement. And these are the little things. Picking up the phone, talking to the patient, listening to the patient, helping them understand their diagnosis, helping them with their prescriptions to make sure that they get filled, and making sure they coordinate care with other providers. Very, very simple things. And finally, Canadians need to insist on and hold accountable our leaders at all levels in the health system. I include myself in that. I would include the Dean of Medicine in any province. There's 17 of them, so it should be hard to corral them and make sure we got the right medical education program for this country. We are training the right numbers for the right for the needs of the population. I know Jim is involved in spearheading an exercise right now across the country on that. We need to make sure our nurses are fully trained and are able and willing to work in expanded scopes of practice. Same for our pharmacists, same for our dietitians and the like. And obviously we need our health administrators and we need our government officials, both at the bureaucratic and elected levels, to be held accountable for their decisions. And we can only hold them accountable if we know what, in fact, they are trying to achieve. And you have to ask yourself, do we, in fact, have plans, targets, benchmarks that we can, in fact, hold our governments accountable for our healthcare system and the outcomes that we want? We have one or two examples where, in fact, it has worked and is working, and that's around wait times. They've got together. They agreed on benchmarks. We now know where we are relative to heart surgeries, some diagnostic services, and the like. When we asked the Netherlands in terms of what makes their system successful, and the UK, that's what they pointed to. We have publicly agreed plans in how we're going to improve our system, and we are held accountable for it, and we report out on their results. We don't have that in Canada. Our job at the Health Council was, in fact, is in fact, to do that. But we can only measure what somebody tells us they want to achieve. And right now, we're relatively silent on that key point. And finally, we need to shift to a healthier Canada agenda. Again, the research will tell us that in solving healthcare, the healthcare issues of the population, the healthcare system probably contributes 25% of the solution. The other 75% are dealing with the social determinants of health. Now, within that are some of our genetics and all of that, and Newfoundland has got some good stories to tell around that. That aside, it is, 60 to 75% of healthcare is outside the domain and influence of the healthcare system. So we need to always keep that in mind. So we put out a report recently called Stepping It Up to get government ministries and other sectors around the table when it talks about the health of a community or a province or a country. And that's found favor in the media and in the research community. I haven't heard a lot back from the governments yet, but we're optimistic. So can Canada own the podium for patient care and health outcomes? I'd say if we have the will, yes. Can Newfoundland and Labrador lead the way? Yes. And I say that based on a couple things. One is just my knowledge of dealing with the system here over the years. But we are well served on all the key factors that make up a healthcare system. We have a shared, I think, political perspective. Each of the parties would agree that, yes, we need to make sure we have a good, sound, strong healthcare system. It needs to be universal. We have a well-trained primary healthcare community supported by a medical school, which is a leader in the country, around family medicine and other disciplines. We have the basis in building an electronic health record system for this province so that we can share health information among providers and among communities and across the province. We're focused on telehealth, teletriage. We have so many of the building blocks that many other provinces are still struggling with. But do we have a plan to pull it all together and move forward? That's where I think our current challenge may lie. So that's where I'm going to leave it. Jim has got lots of solutions for us, and he's in the trenches, so I'll pass it over to him.
Well, that's a tough act to follow. And I can say, John, it's such a pleasure to work with you again in your role in Health Council of Canada and again in your role as Deputy Minister of Health here in Newfoundland and Labrador going back a few years. Thank you to the Harris Center for putting this on, for NLCHR, for also co-sponsoring it, to Memorial, and to all of you for coming out on a stormy day, and also my staff for helping with the presentation. Well, like Herman, we all know we're going to need healthcare sooner or later, and it's a little easier to tell our healthcare now than what we're going to need in the year 2020 as individuals or societies in Newfoundland or in Canada. So nobody really has the answer, but unless we start thinking about it, we're not going to do as well as if we don't think about it, keep our head in the sand. And I've been very fortunate to work at the national level with a lot of people thinking about the year 2020 and beyond. As Michael said at the start, we're interviewing for medical students right now, and those students will start in the fall. They'll graduate in 2015, and they'll start work, if we're lucky, as a specialist in 2020. So what we do today has a big impact on what happens in 2020. So some of us really have to start thinking about that. And the Deans of Medicine have spent a lot of time over the last 30 months in a national project to look at the future medical education Canada. We felt it was about time because the last time there was a report like this was Abraham Flexner 100 years ago. So it was time to get around and do this. And we've really focused and agreed on the top 10 priorities we need to address, everything from admissions to really meeting the needs of Canadians. We're now embarking on another 30-month project to look at our entire postgraduate residency training programs to see how we can tailor those to meet the needs in 2020 and beyond. Other groups have been looking at this as well. I was fortunate to sit in the task force for the Academic Health Science Centres in Canada. Their report came out last spring. Three missions, one future. Again, that's looking at the critical need to combine clinical care with education research so that we can apply the most cost-effective advanced solutions to the practice of healthcare in Canada, and the need to get rid of the word academic health science centers and call them academic health science networks that have responsibility for the entire region, or in this case, the entire province, of making sure that the education research gets out into practice. But having said that, John highlighted a number of what I think we can identify as new realities and needs. And when we look at those new realities and needs, Newfoundland and Labrador leads the way. Canada's population is aging. We know that seniors with chronic diseases are sicker and have increased health care costs. Again, Newfoundland and Labrador leads the way. I'm going to just zero in on this particular topic for a few minutes and give a bit more depth on it. And thanks to the Economics and Statistics Branch of the Department of Finance for the few slides here that I'm going to show on some more detailed statistics. This one I found quite interesting. We have done a real flip-flop here in Newfoundland and Labrador from being one of Canada's youngest provinces to its oldest province. And if we look a little further at this, it's actually quite interesting. The top line is the population between 15 and 64 years old, the working population that supports the rest of it. The red line is the students between 0 and 14. The people between 0 and 14 years, and it's gone from 200,000 down to below 100,000 in the province. And the ever-increasing bottom blue line is those over 65 years old. Now, this will have an impact in healthcare because we know that those over 65 years old will undoubtedly require more services than those underneath. Currently, they consume on average about four times as much healthcare services and dollars as those under 65. This is also another interesting slide that they presented, and this is the elderly dependency ratios. So what this is calculated by the population age 65 or over divided by the population between 15 and 64. And again, you'll see that Newfoundland and Labrador leads the way. So a couple of other realities that tie into this. Canada is a rural country, and that makes health care access to and delivery more difficult and more expensive. And again, Newfoundland and Labrador leads the way. It's a beautiful spot, this country of ours. The rural areas are treasures. Who in the audience knows where this picture might be taken from? It's tilting on Fogo Island, courtesy of Dr. Leslie Rourke, my wife, who took this this lovely picture. And there are so many beautiful spots around this province. Such a rural treasure is this province. But here's some statistics of interest. You know, in Canada, about 20% of the population is rural, if you define that as including communities up to 10,000 that aren't right near big centers. And in Newfoundland and Labrador, it's 60% of the population. Now, when you put that together with the age projection, this is what you get. I'll give you a moment to look at this slide, but I found this quite dramatic. All the red dots are the communities that will have an average age of over 55 in the year 2025. There's a whole lot of them. In fact, most of Newfoundland are those small communities where we're going to have the rural elderly are going to be a huge care component for our population. And there's only a few areas where the population is going to be younger than that, 24 to 47. That's in Labrador itself and in around the St. John's area. So I thought that was quite an interesting side. That's the reality that we're looking at as we go forward. So I've changed the heading a little bit here to change the focus of my talk. You'll see it reads new realities and needs, but not bolded. What's bolded now is opportunities. And I think we have to look at the concepts of moving from lagging to leading and how we convert new realities to needs. So, for example, we know that we have these needs. We can convert them to realities. We convert these needs and realities to opportunities. We know for sure there'll be a lot of elderly patients and people out there that we're going to have to look after and encourage them to stay well. In fact, this reminds me of a lovely elderly patient that I used to look after. And on days like we've had the last few days, he'd say, "Oh, Dr. Rourke, it's cold enough to feel the holes in my long underwear." And then he'd always ask me a disarming question: "What do you know for sure today, doctor?" Oh my gosh, and sort of reel back in your heels and, well, what do you know for sure today? Well, we do know that the population of Newfoundland and Labrador will have a lot of elderly people. I want to talk about that a bit more, about how we can actually address that issue in a very positive way here. And if we're leading the country in the problem, let's lead the country in the solution. And here's some of the ways I think we can do it. Now, I don't show this slide because this is an old feller. This is actually Dr. Roger Butler. Roger Butler grew up in Belle Island, and his 86-year-old mother still lives there. And we've actually seen his mother tooling around over in Belle Island, and it's just grand. But Roger's got quite an understanding of this field of the elderly. His focus and practice, now that he's now on faculty here, and he was a rural doctor for many years, but in faculty, is in the care of the elderly. Now, Roger went on sabbatical a little bit over a year ago, and you folks may be wondering, what in the world does Memorial send these people on sabbatical? My gosh, what do they do when they're away in sabbatical? Well, Roger, when he was away in sabbatical, he looked at care of the elderly in other parts of the world and how he could streamline and make that care more efficient. And he found out that places that have a care of the elderly assessment unit right linked to the emergency department in hospitals can help get rid of the clutter and the clogging in the emergency departments, can help these people get looked after and assessed more appropriately, can lead to shorter hospital stays, less complications happening in hospital, and people getting out of hospital quicker and healthier and less costly. This is the kind of new thinking that we need to apply to this. Another kind of new thinking: increasing the value for money in the Canadian healthcare system, new findings and contribution to primary care services. John Abbott referred to this a little bit, but this study is a striking study because a Canadian study was set primarily in BC, and they looked at elderly people with chronic disease conditions, such as diabetes, such as congestive heart failure, and they found that if those people were looked after by a family doctor, the cost of looking after them was a third than if they didn't really have a family doctor looking after them. A third, imagine that. And that those people not only had lower healthcare costs, but their morbidity and mortality was much improved. Now, we know it's not just about family doctors, but we do know that we really have to focus on training more family doctors. And what's emerging now in the most recent critical thinking is the concept of a medical home. The medical home includes a family doctor working with a nurse practitioner, other nursing supports, social worker, occupational therapist, physiotherapist in a medical home that provides the ready-to-use access for people so they can get much of the care at one place and have that all looked after and have that linked into the whole healthcare system. And so if we really focus on how to make primary health care work, it's a teamwork. It's not the doctor, but we do have that medical home concept. And we know if we do that, the health care costs for this large and increasing group of people will be dramatically lower, and they'll be much feeling better because of that. This was just in the Telegram just a couple of days ago, but it refers to another study, and I think this is an important study. And I've talked about chronic conditions demand more services. But what I want you to read is the line underneath that. Local doctor agrees with study that healthy seniors require less medical care. So we are now know from the studies, and we see it around us, we have a lot of healthy seniors, people that have an active mind and an active body, and the more that we can have people like Dr. Max House, who is an epitome of the healthy, active senior, in his 80s, still going strong. In fact, he was in to see me recently about another one of his research projects. Dr. House was one of the founders and world leaders in telemedicine in the whole world, right here in Newfoundland, Labrador. And he's still got a passion with that, and is in to see me about the teledementia project that he's currently leading and working on with other people to try to address that issue in Newfoundland, Labrador. If only we can all be as active and vigorous as Dr. House in his 80s. Or Dr. Nigel Rusted in his hundreds. And he's now 103, and I was driving him a little while ago to an event, and he said to me, you know, Dr. Rourke, actually, if you turn right here, I'll show you a shortcut. Well, how good is that? So I think that really what we have to do is if seniors get sick, we have to make sure their hospital experience is efficient and effective, and there are ways to improve on that. If seniors, if we can keep them out of hospital through better primary health care that's with this medical home concept involving family doctors and the whole team, even better. And the best thing is if we can have seniors who are going to be active minds and active bodies so we can have more Nigel Rusteds and Dr. Houses. Well, let's talk about a few other things. And I can go on for a long time, and I want to save time for questions. So I'm going to talk about a couple of other things I think, again, we can be leading. Emerging tech and other opportunities, emerging technologies, new tests, drugs, treatments, information communication technologies. We talked about the internet. Another area of technology is genetics. What a huge explosion we've seen there. And genetics and our environment team up. They're wicked when they do that to produce illness. And again, Newfoundland Labrador has a unique genetic problems, which many of you are familiar with in your families. The healthcare teams are familiar with them. But it also is a unique opportunity, and I'll just briefly touch on again how this is an area where we can lead the way as an example of how we lead the way. I think most of you know about the sudden cardiac death, the ARVC gene discovery, and I'll just very briefly tell you about that, and I'll touch into why and how that's an example of what we can do here and how it can actually save costs. So for years, as you know, families in Newfoundland had what was called the black curse, and young men and women would die suddenly of cardiac disease. And we found out that an autopsy, it was because their conduction system in their heart had a bit of fiber or fat that made the heart suddenly fibrillate and really stop working, and they died suddenly. We found out by looking at this more carefully that it ran in families, and sort of every other one. And we found out that if we were to put pacemakers in, which are these little things here with defibrillators, that we could stop them from dying suddenly. But we still didn't know who to put it in, who not to put it in. If you had two brothers, did you put in them both of them? Or, I mean, you knew you only had to put in one of them, but what if you put in the wrong one? You know, not so good. So we again used our genetic experience here on our team here to crack the genetic code to determine with the test who needs to have it and who doesn't. So now we know we only have to put in half as many as we would have had before. Obviously, people are living because of this treatment, but we're a cost-effective way to apply that. And that's a genetic breakthrough. Now, let me tell you how that's going to set the stage for the future. The Health Science Center, there's lots of construction going on. You've seen the parking building going up because we're putting the parking lot, a new genetics center. Now, that genetics center is going to allow us to bring together everything we've been doing under one roof to lead the way, I believe, in the world in this process, certainly in Canada. And that was a Canadian Foundation for Innovation competition for funding. that $500 million at play here in a competition open to research hospitals and medical school partners. Now, the big people like University of Toronto had 3 or 4 applications like McGill did. We put together our very best team and went out and competed head-on with them. We had the full support of the government, the full support of Eastern Health, Memorial University, and our model of trying to put things together horizontally, vertically, to do this patient-oriented kind of research, we get the answers like in the ARVC gene. And after a very rigorous process, there were 8 winners announced, and we were one of those 8 winners for the federal funding for this project, with Memorial providing the partner funding, with Newfoundland Labrador providing partner funding. 8 winners. We built University of British Columbia, University of Calgary, University of Alberta, Dalhousie University, for example, to be one of those 8 winners. So we can compete in areas where we have unique needs and opportunities. So that's why I think we've got these unique needs, but they can be opportunities. This area, when it's completed in 2013, will have patient care. It'll be the founder population studies, which is our wonderful group of people that provide the need, but also research data. The biomolecular labs, the advanced informatics, clinical epidemiology, legal ethics and health policy, health system research and development, because you've got to get it from the concept right back in the health system, and commercialization. So what we discover here will be applied around the world, and there will be some commercialization opportunities in Newfoundland and royalty streams as well from this. That's an artist concept of what the building will look like in 2013, and this will also allow us to expand the medical school as well. I'll talk about that in a minute. So Canada is a rural country. So as I said earlier, in our needs and realities, it makes healthcare delivery more expensive, more difficult for patients, for everybody. And yes, we are the most rural province. This is a Nain clinic up in Nain. Actually, that's Dr. Leslie Rourke up doing a clinic there several years ago, and myself. And I'm fortunate as dean. I get out to do site visits all around the place to get a better connection of what's happening out there. And I find that if I see some patients, help provide some care, talk to the nurses, all the staff, I get a much better idea of what the needs are. And this is an example of how we're addressing some of the rural healthcare issues. This is Dr. Michael Jong, one of my heroes, a physician up in Goose Bay, Happy Valley, Goose Bay, full-time faculty member. And he's talking to a nurse in Nain using telemedicine to help manage a patient there. Now, telemedicine is something that we actually, is not a dream. It's something we actually use here. So the telemedicine here we use for telepsychiatry. And so they may be talking to patients and saving the patient having to fly many, many, many miles to come in with that. Maybe managing, we've got a tele-oncology program that lets people get their oncology care, their cancer treatment closer to home without having to drive all the way to St. John's. We've got a tele-dementia project being developed underway. But we've even got some advanced programs. And this, again, is where we're leading the world. This is Rosie the robot. I've worked with Rosie
to do their job. And such things as clinical practice guidelines, other decision support tools, electronic health and medical record system, all of that are where we lack relative to many other countries, leading countries. On the issue around incentives and fee for service and alternate payment arrangements, sort of the research is mixed generally in that in terms of the results. So we're really not sure which payment system really is most effective. But what we do know is that when plans are put in place and targets are set for whatever service or for whatever group of providers, that's where you see change and you see improved performance. And the pay issue tends to be secondary.
That's a very interesting challenge thing. John says the results are mixed in terms of which mechanisms provide the best results, and each one has different results that can be good or bad depending on circumstances. By and large, mixed system tends to produce the more favorable results. I can say that in some jurisdictions, Ontario, for example, the funding for primary health care has changed dramatically over the last 5 years. And the majority of physicians in Ontario now are paid as part of a family health team or a family health group. There's a number of different acronyms there, where they're paid by and large so much per year for looking after a group of patients as opposed to individual services. We've also seen in many jurisdictions, in the rural areas, the communities with the governments provide facilities because it's again, you need that infrastructure support, the team support, to have then the doctor come in and work with that kind of support environment. So there's a lot of movement happening in Canada in that regard, and I think we'll see continued movement here in that regard as well as we move forward.
We have Lee in orange, and then we have three in a row on that side.
Hi, my name's Lee Adams, and I'm doing my PhD at the University of Alberta, but pursuing doing my study here in the Newfoundland population of seniors, particularly seniors with mental illness and how to use acute hospitals. So, Dr. House, your comments were a great segue into my comment, I guess. We all know dementia is one of the challenges of the future healthcare system, and oftentimes seniors arrive at the doorstep of our hospitals with mental illness to emerge, admitted into hospital as inpatients, so on and so forth. But very often, even just my review of the literature alone, coming into a system, we don't have the right expertise, the knowledge, or the skill to do an accurate assessment of these seniors that have mental illness. That's just what I found so far, just my lit review alone. And so therefore, if they're not accurately assessed or diagnosed, therefore they're not accurately treated. So therefore, they end up staying in hospital a lot longer than is necessary and so on. A couple questions, I guess, from the ground up on a go-forward basis, from a healthcare perspective. Is there anything that we can do in terms of, Dr. Rourke, you spoke about your subspecialties, maybe we need maybe a focus on geriatric psychiatry, for example, from such an academic program you have. And for John, I'm just wondering if one of your 11 chronic conditions that you identified earlier in your talk included any mental illnesses at all in those categories. So thank you.
I can answer yes for me and pass it to him.
I can answer yes too, and I'll add a few more words to my answer. Yes, indeed. In psychiatry, there has been a lot of push for geriatric psychiatry. Geriatric psychiatry is just recognized as a subspecialty by the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Canada. At our Memorial Residency Training Programs, again, we recently replaced and hired some more geriatric psychiatry people because we think that's an important part of the focus. In terms of all general medicine, again, we've got some leaders here, Dr. Ann Slater, geriatrician in the province, Dr. Wendy Young, a nursing researcher here, again, great resource here. A lot of focus, Dr. Marshall Godwin family, doing a lot of research on actually addressing the needs of keeping the elderly healthy and what to do when they get ill. I think, again, it gets down on the ground, though. What happens to people on the ground when things go wrong, and is there a way to make it a more effective and efficient and better experience for them? And I think there's a lot of room all across Canada to address this particular area. And I go back to the idea that Roger Butler has brought back from his studies in sabbatical about that if we have the proper assessment units, we know from those that we can reduce both the complications of extended hospital stay and have people emerge healthier sooner and have less mortality in hospitals as well. So I think we really have to think from a systems way, both from the ground up and the top down.
Thank you. We're the lady with the black shirt, then we'll have another one from emailed in to Mike, and then gentleman with the gray sweater, and then back up here.
All right, hi, I'm Jessica. My question or query has roots from two different aspects and background. First of all, I'm a graduating kinesiology student, and I grew up in a small, isolated rural town in Labrador. First of all, I find the acute care in my community very, very effective. The acute care in Labrador, I think, is very good for what is necessary. However, I find there's a lot lacking in preventive medicine, particularly for young populations. I know the focus of this discussion has mostly been seniors so far. However, the younger populations in Newfoundland and Labrador are also facing higher issues. For instance, you mentioned obesity, both of your presentations. And I was just wondering on your comments on if there would be, or if there should be any focus on preventative medicine for illnesses, chronic illnesses in young populations in their future.
Thank you.
Well, I would certainly agree on that. And the question, obviously, then is how best one does that. And I know in my former life with the department here, we were working with the education department and school boards to expand the availability of services through the school boards because they were obviously in the classroom, in school, those activities. So we were very supportive of working through the education sector to help deliver on those issues. And my point, I guess, in the presentation is, yes, the health system cannot get, is not present in all communities, nor should it be. There are other avenues. The education system, the municipal system, definitely is certainly a strong point for me. So we need to bring them in, talk about, from a needs assessment in any community, that, yeah, what can we do collectively to address this issue, which is a concern, is the health of our youth. And Labrador, and our Aboriginal community in particular, that's, again, another big, big challenge.
And thanks for raising the issue in question from Labrador. And again, if you remember the map I showed, that's the one area where the population is young and growing. I think we particularly need to address it there, but all over. And again, remembering that what do we do in our youth and our early adulthood determines so much of our health and later stages, what to say is so very true. I think the health system in general has not paid enough attention to prevention. And I think there are so many aspects to that that we could touch on, but it needs to be a collective effort of all the players involved giving the individuals the knowledge and urge to do healthier lifestyles through the support they need in the communities. I've seen whole communities become transformed by the development of community centers where it provides activities for the youth and activities for the all ages. And again, I think there is a potential as we have this develop a health tomorrow strategy that we can focus on those kind of things in our communities.
And if I may, one other critical aspect of this is the, I'll call it health literacy, and ability to participate. Because if you're in a family with low income on social assistance, your ability to even hear a message, let alone deal with it, is... you're compromised right at the beginning. So that's why poverty reduction strategy as a provincial policy here is being watched across the country, because it is really focused on raising incomes and targeting program to that particular population. I think it's fair to say that people in this room understand all the messages. Now, whether we act on them is another matter. But for right across the country, we've seen that that low-income communities, neighborhoods, or certainly large centers, Toronto is an example, You can pinpoint where health issues are in any community, and it's in those low-income neighborhoods. And we need, as part of this discussion, to make sure we are really focused on the right populations. So a mass production of eat, live well, eat well, is not going to do it. We've plateaued on that. Now we've got to drill down and deal with the communities that are most at risk, and we know where they are. And in Labrador, we know the Aboriginal communities. As a key point.
Thank you. We'll have another check-in on Mike's health and see the latest emailed question.
We've got two questions that are somewhat related, so maybe I'll ask them at the same time. Doctors need allied health professionals to perform their work more efficiently. They are the ones who can keep people in their homes, yet the majority of allied health professionals are in the hospitals. How do we people recognize the need that there are more nurses and doctors need in the system? Government seems fixed on keeping resources as they are and giving the squeaky wheel the most attention. So the question is from Sharon Lur King.
So I don't know who the squeaky wheel is, but I mean, again, from the health council's perspective, what we've been advocating and what governments have said they want to do through their health portfolios is to improve and expand primary health care teams across this country. So that's where we bring all health professionals working in teams so that the physician is using his or her medical trained clinical skills to address those issues, and nurses are dealing in their scope of practice on the issues that they best manage. And where those are put in place, access improves, the number of patients that can be seen increases, the quality of service increases, the satisfaction increases, the cost comes down. Simple math. But we've been very slow moving on that front. So to the point, yes, allied health professionals need to be part of those teams, and if that means at times moving from one sector to the other to address a community need, so be it.
Also, Kelly Power King asks about nurse practitioners in healthcare, similar kind of question, so that applies as well.
But again, we have a great program here in this province, one of the best in the country, but are we using the graduates to their fullest scope of practice? No, we should be.
Again, pick up that I've helped train a nurse practitioners. I've worked with nurse practitioners. And I think the real key to success here is having the nurses, the practitioners, the social workers, the OTs, the physiotherapies, all part of that connected medical home. It's not about having people go off and do independent things, but trying to build a whole team network of that to support the team process.
Yeah. And then through that process, so the example for a senior presenting with mental health issues or mental illness, and that gets picked up the visit to the family physician. It shouldn't show up at the emergency room. And we're all connected to some family physician, so we need to support that point of entry to the system so that these crises, these emergency room visits, can come down and we provide better care.
Okay. Gentlemen at the front, and John can head up to the back for two ladies on the left back there after this.
My name is David Thompson. My question is about the cost of drugs and who pays for them. It's mostly directed to John Abbott. In your excellent presentation quite early, you showed a slide which showed that the cost of drugs is now higher than the total cost of physicians. and it's rising fast. Now, when we have a new genetic center, we know, of course, that genetically based drugs are going to be even more expensive in the future. So my worry is that since the beginning of Medicare, physician care is covered by the Medicare system, but drugs in general aren't. So as the cost of drugs goes up compared with the cost of physicians, is it not going to be the case that we're going to end up with a more private system and less of a public system? Or is there any future solution to a pharmacare program? What are we going to do about cost of drugs compared with the cost of physicians in the future?
Okay. Well, that's one area that the Health Council has done a fair bit of work on over the past number of years. Governments had agreed back in 2003, 2004 to put a plan in place. They call it catastrophic drug coverage. Some could argue that it should be universal, like Medicare. And some European countries have it, and they recognize the need to do that. Currently, in Canada, we have a patchwork of programs. Each province does it differently. Newfoundland and Labrador, we have programs that cover different populations, as well as to support purchase of drugs if your cost of drugs exceeds a certain percentage of your income. And so we moved a long way in Newfoundland in a relatively short period of time. But it's still not, one could argue, the ideal. I think one of the pressures on governments over the next while, it's their day, and will be, I think, leading to 2013-14, is to finally come to a resolution on that question. What is it we should have and need to have in Canada? Should it be universal coverage? Should it be at least catastrophic coverage so that these depending on your income, wherever you are in Canada, you will have access. And the story is told, I won't say best, but certainly told, when you talk to Canadians who are dealing with cancer and need to purchase medications. And right now, across this country, we have patchwork. Many people feel that, in fact, it should be under Medicare. And from a cost review, there have been some studies that have suggested that if it was brought in, it could actually be cheaper than currently. So that, I think, is going to be that and the whole issue of home and continuing care are the two program areas or policy areas that are going to be getting a lot of attention over the next couple of years to bring those to a resolution.
Okay. Lady with gray. Yep.
Hi, I'm Julia Trahe, Dean Rourke, Mr. Abbott. I'm really enjoying all the discussion, and as Dean Rourke knows, I am very much involved in healthcare from 18 to over 100. Absent from many of these discussions is the issue of secondary care, which is close to my heart, which I think in rural areas is a major player as well in healthcare delivery. We will be facing a problem for secondary healthcare services in general internal medicine across the country over the same time frame, the next 10, 15 years. So I was wondering if there has been any discussion. I know Dean Rourke and I have had it personally, but I would like to hear particularly Mr. Abbott if that has come up in any of the discussions having at a national level.
I know we've had it as well, but not specifically, though, right at the present time, one of the areas that we are looking at the Health Council is the whole issue around health human resources, physician supply, nurse supply, and all the components that make up a particular profession. So I've sort of flagged that as a particular issue. And as Jim said in terms of his presentation, looking at Newfoundland Labrador in terms of the geographical distribution and the needs. So we do need to make sure we have good needs assessment on a regular basis because the population needs are changing. Do we need to build more, facilities and add more equipment, shall we say, as an example, in our rural communities? Or do we need to figure out a better way of making sure that the residents have access to the appropriate services, high-quality services, and they get to them at minimal or no cost? So I think that's part of what we need to address here in Newfoundland, but it has to be an open discussion, and everything sort of has to put on the table. So the Jim's graphs, when you talk about projections, I know for years the government of Newfoundland would hide the population projections. What are we going to do with it politically? You know, once it got up there and people understood, yes, we know our communities are aging. We know our young, children and teenagers, graduates are moving to other provinces. But once we got the information, we could start planning, thinking about how we address it. So we need, again, to do the same for the healthcare challenges. You put it out to a very specific one, and we need to put that all on the table and quote unquote map this out for our generation, but ideally for those who follow us.
Okay. You've raised a really interesting and I think important point that has lost a lot of policymakers who tend to live in big cities, and they are familiar with the environment around them. And the needs of medicine in the big cities in terms of the role of general specialists is quite different than the needs out in smaller places like Cornbrook, Grand Falls, and Anthony Goose Bay. And we've also seen the way the fee schedule things are set up, that graduates tend to want to choose a narrow specialty as opposed to the broader specialties. We're currently looking at this nationally in terms of how we can actually address that in our project with the Royal College of Surgeons of Canada and the College of Family Physicians of Canada, try to see how we can address the gap. But we're identifying that as a clear gap between the general specialists, particularly for those kinds of communities. And to agree that has not had success very much last decade. It's a real gap that has to be addressed. I hope we're successful at it. The jury's still out as to how well we'll do in that area. Big challenge.
Okay, we have three left. I think, guys, do you have any paper up there? Or if you're smart enough to remember the questions right here? I'm going to make those three questions in a row without answering so that we finish on time. So you're warned. John, lady up in the orange, and then Rebecca, lady in the purple there, in the middle, the you'll find her. And then John, you run down here to Mike, who has another emailed question. So, up the back there.
Hi, Debbie Fort, and thank you very much for your presentation. And John, you stole a bit of my thunder, because you talked about a national pharmacare program, a national publicly funded home care program, which I think if we're going to make any inroads in this country, we have to start putting some political pressure on the federal level as well to bring those two programs in place, because we're not going to keep people out of hospitals or out of healthcare facilities unless we make sure they have home care and that their drugs are paid for. But my question is, I guess, around primary health care and how we move that agenda forward, because I've been around that block before. We saw some dedicated funding come from the federal government in the late 90s around primary health care, and it was like pushing a rock up a hill with 100 people pushing back on the other end. And we hear the same thing over and over again. Dr. Rourke, you talk about medical homes. I prefer to call them community health centers myself, because I think it's about building around a community and different health care providers. But how do we move that agenda forward? Because we've been there and we've done it, and we're not getting anywhere with that. And we've had several governments come and go, and I, you know, agree with the Dr. Butler in terms of how do we push that political agenda. Because, you know, we want to be at that table as nurses. We want to be at a table, and we've been pushing that agenda for a long time, and no one's listening. And second question, and you might not answer them all, is, you know, I agree that I'm tired of research, and we need to get to action. We have a lot of research in this country around what needs to be done in terms of best practices, how we improve work environments. No one's listening on that either. And how do we get people to listen who make right decisions? Because it's really frustrating when you know what needs to be done, and no one is listening.
Thank you. We'll keep track of that. No answers yet. We'll come back to them. Up to Rebecca, and then John, you can come down, Mike, with the mic. Yes, your turn up there.
Me?
Yep.
Oh, okay, Leslie Rourke, family physician here in St. John's, and I look after people from all age groups. And despite all we've spoken about our demographics and the elderly, I want to just sort of enlarge on what was said earlier about youth and take it further down. Because we know, and I'm looking at birth to age 5 years, don't forget about our youngest and our most vulnerable, because that is where we get our best bang for the buck. It certainly is known that there are critical periods in brain development in children, much as the same way as if you don't see clearly the back of your eye up to age 5 years, it never does develop so that you will see properly if you put glasses on. The same thing has been found for things like the way we respond emotionally, the way we hear and process things, the way we can learn, the way we deal with numbers. A lot of those things are determined by the time we reach 5 years of age. And we also know that stress that children have as babies determines the way their mental health develops and their physical health. So I would make a plea for when we're looking at all these things that we don't forget about the youngest and most vulnerable, and look at some of the initiatives that are happening elsewhere to do with helping children develop in healthy ways.
Thank you. And last question, emailed in via Mike.
The question comes from Azad Hezakni. Hope I've got your name right. There are many research projects in the area of optimization and operations research with the sole focus on healthcare in some other provinces, among others BC, Ontario. Is there any plan to start these kind of initiatives here in research Newfoundland Labrador? So getting at the efficiency and effectiveness question.
Thank you, Mike. John, I'll let you go first with any and or all those, plus any closing comment you have.
Okay.
And then Jim can do a wrap-up.
The forwards question around primary health care, renewal reform, what have you. When you started speaking, I said, well, if I knew what I know now back a couple of years ago, I think I would say I would hope that we're further ahead. I am encouraged about what is happening based in other, some of what's happening in provinces. We went through the same kinds of challenges I think that we still have here.
Ontario, BC are good examples. We held a forum this time last roughly this time last year, and we brought again some leadership in the country around this issue because each province was at different stages and having different challenges. One of the key things that we found, and then I hark back and where we are and we're in our Newfoundland, was around governance. In that fact, we said we wanted to do it. We said physicians and nurses, whatever, go ahead and do it. Yeah, we'll talk about it. But we never put in and have yet to put in the supports to make the darn thing work. In Ontario, they finally figured it out, and they're doing that. Quebec and BC are putting in governance models. Quebec is sort of top-down. BC's is bottom-up. So I think what we're going to see over the next short period of time is a lot more momentum. So we can learn from that. But we do need a governance model. We need government and the medical association and association, again, to say, yeah, we commit to this because they're your national organizations and both the all of the advocacy side as well as the professional side have all agreed this is where we need to go. So I think it's now re-engaged the government on that. And I think if the community supports, this is what we want and pushed harder for, we could have in place. Research, you've heard me, we can apply more and need to do that. On the issue around the Leslie's comment on birth, child, early childhood health, currently the Health Council is sponsoring workshops across the country with our Aboriginal communities on this very issue because we are seeing dramatic, we know about the dramatic differences in health status of our Aboriginal population and I'll say our southern white population. And we are addressing that right now. And what we're looking at is what is in fact working in our Aboriginal communities. How can they share within and across those communities? And ideally, what can we learn as well? It is a specifically, again, challenging issue for Canada. The Prime Minister is out trying to solve this for the world. We're saying we need to solve it in our own backyard. And here are the issues and here are the evidence that we need you to address. And I think Health Canada has been very supportive of us in doing this work because it's another way of getting in to identify and address the issues. But it can only be addressed if the communities have the capacity to, in fact, identify and address it. Yes, we provide other reports. The fact that we see so, and even in, I've gotten statistics in Labrador, because I was curious how many children are born in their communities versus coming into Happy Valley Goose Bay. Very, very few, and it's only because of an emergency. So they're still flown in, whether that's right or wrong, that's the communities to decide. But we certainly know in Northern Canada, mothers want to have their children in their communities. They don't want to have be flying out to Edmonton and Winnipeg and Ottawa to have their children. So it's a big issue right across the board. So, yeah.
Thanks very much. And again, in response to before's comments, I think in bringing these things forward, I'm encouraged by what's been happening in other jurisdictions. But it has been a difficult developmental time as those brought forward, trying to work out the details, the governments, the model to actually get one that actually works. We're only now seeing some models that are actually working enough that they're attractive for people to be part of and seeing good results from those. So I think we can almost have a slingshot effect here and learn from what's best practice models we're emerging for family healthcare teams, community health centers, medical homes is emerging across the country and bring that best evidence back to here. We can do a catch up and go ahead kind of approach there. Certainly in terms of the birth to age 5, the cost effectiveness is simply outstanding in terms of early intervention, makes so much difference there. And some provinces putting a premium on providing care of the children from birth to 5 and key milestone interventions. And I think we need to consider that here and as well across the country, that's going to be a key area because intervention there has been shown to reduce so many things in the future health and well-being of those individuals that grow up. In terms of optimization, make the whole system more effective, more efficient, better experience for patients in terms of their outcome and their experience of going through it. I think that's where the big gains are going to be need to be made. I do think we have to put in action both a longer-term overall plan, but I think we have to address the inefficiencies, things that can be done better at every stage along the way, looking at a patient-centered approach, because it's really around you, the people, and making it work for you, the people, the patients who go into the system, and trying to keep out of the system, but better home and all those things that we're going to make the progress we need to make here. Big challenges in this province, but I think the big opportunities, I think together we can have a chance to really make a difference here. And I think we have areas we can lead the way, and the more we can do that, I think the better. It's a small place, so we've got population-wise, small place with 4 regional health authorities, so I think we have a chance to be more nimble and respond to what the evidence is out there than other places. So I'd like to thank everyone for coming. I assume Robbie will do a bit more of this, but I certainly enjoyed it. It's been a privilege to be here. The questions come in both from around here, but out and about as well, and it's been all good. So thank you, everybody. Have a healthy night.
Thank you, Jim and John, and we'll thank you a little bit more in a minute. I have a couple of quick wrap-up questions, so you're allowed out until you fill in your evaluation forms. If you're in the room, you can drop them as you go out the door. We will have a reception at 9:30 right now when we finish up. For anybody who wants to stick around who's in the room, there's a box at the back that Rebecca is holding up there. Put your evaluation forms in there. If you're viewing on the web, you can click on the screen, and it only takes a minute. We really need your input on this session and ideas for future sessions. A couple of quick thank yous, really important. Thanks to John Bonnell and a great crew at Dell Distance Education Learning Technologies at Memorial. They're world leaders for yet another great job. Thank you, guys. Memorial's Marketing and Communications Division, the great staff at the Hare Center. It's a nice coincidence here tonight. The staff holding the mics love to embarrass people on the fly. John Duff and Rebecca Coho hold mics in other parts of their lives. John's a member of the Idlers and Rebecca a member of the Subtitles. So go out and buy your CD. I don't know if music is a social determinant of health, but probably should be. Our co-sponsors, Newfoundland Labrador Center for Applied Health Research, especially Stephen Borenstein, Teresa McKenzie, and James Butler. Roger Cable will be broadcasting this, so we're delighted to have that relationship with Rogers. Most importantly, and it came up here this evening several times about how to get governments to stick to long-term plans and implement some of what we've learned. And that's a big part of what the Harris Center is all about. You coming out on a night like this, voting with your feet, it's only through an informed electorate we make any difference at all. I think governments often suffer from this is us syndrome. And governance is about non-governmental organizations and citizens working with government. That's a lot of what we're about. And we're practicing what we preach here tonight. So thank you to you. Janice now is going to present some gifts to our speakers, and thanks especially to them. Great job, guys.
Thank you.
And now you can go, and please join us in the reception.